Welcome again. We'll start with the Yojana, the June edition that focused on empowering youth. Now, when we talk about empowering youth, there are few most important things that we must understand. First of all, out of the total population, 27.5% is the population of the youth group that's from the age of 15 to 19 years. Now, each of the youth that is there is engaged in different activities. Now, when we talk about the employment, nearly 38% of the youth is employed in agricultural related activities, 19% in trade, hotel and related activities, 15% in construction and around 13% in manufacturing. Now, UNESCO mentions youth as a period of transition from childhood to adulthood. There are various initiatives that have been provided by government. For example, the Skill India, the Skill Development, Kaushal Vikas Yojana and so on. Now, some of the important things that we would be highlighting here is the youth is capable of generating output, and this is based on the demographic dividend. So, the country which has higher demographic dividend with more youth has more potential for development, definitely. For example, if we talk about Europe, where you have a negative growth rate, you have a declining young population and an increasing old age population. So that old age population is definitely a burden to the society, which is dependent and not productive. So India has that demographic dividend, which is productive. So we must use the youth as a potential power, and this potential power can be an active agency of social change. Technology is one of the means through which youth can interact and bring in more developments. So the idea is to digitally empower the youth and bringing in technology for the development. Now, when we talk about empowering youth, there are few objectives with certain priority areas. For example, if we talk about the first objective, that is creating a productive workforce, for that we need good education, entrepreneurship, employment and skill development. Then we talk about developing a healthy generation, so we need to have a healthy lifestyle. So here we would focus on yoga and related activities. Then you have inspiring social values and community services, so you must have social values and community engagement for the same. Participation and civic engagements requires good governance. And finally, supporting the youth at the risk of equal opportunity talks about social inclusion and social justice. So these are some of the areas that we would focus, and this has been given under the National Youth Policy 2014. That's very, very important for your mains examination. So you have the National Youth Policy. Now, under the current programs, there are some of the programs like Nehru Yuva Kendra Sansthan, National Service Scheme, National Program for Youth and Adolescent Development. Now, as per the 2011 census, 41% of the population is below the age of 20 years. That means India has a very huge potential for future development, at least for the coming 40 years, because till 60 years, if we say you have a development potential, you have this population potential that lies here. Now, Ministry of Annual Report 2016 and 17 has laid down certain suggestions that talks about improving the educational quality, bringing in capacity building, reaching the youth and bringing in awareness programs, creating customized programs for entrepreneurship and improving the service delivery in health sector. Now, when it comes to entrepreneurship, it's said that nearly 54% of the people youth desire to become an entrepreneur, but ultimately when it comes out to the real figure for 1 year, you have only 6% who actually turn out as an entrepreneur. So you have to definitely improve that ratio, because entrepreneurship would lead to more startups would lead to more employment generation. So if you have 6 people who come up with their own firms, each employing at least 5 to 10 people, you would have 30 to 60 people who would get employment. So that's the basic idea that government is focusing on. Now, the next thing are some of the important initiatives. First of the important initiative is the Skill Upgradation Training Program, SUTP, which talks about developing the training skills, promoting the folk art and the Yuva Kirti. The next is Mahatma Gandhi Yuva Swachhata Abhiyan and Shramdan Karyakram. So, Swachhata Abhiyan talks about cleanliness, the Shramdan talks about the conservation and more labor force that could be engaged in. Life skill training for adolescent talks about empowering the adolescent. This includes tribal youth exchange program, Northeast youth exchange program, which talks about developing the Northeast and preserving their cultural heritage. There are certain developments which have been taken in specific regions. For example, in Tamil Nadu, you have a National Institute of Institute of National Importance that has come up in Sri Perambadur. So you have Rajiv Gandhi National Institute for Youth Development established by the Enactment Act 2012. You have many youth hostels that have come up, which are at a culturally or historically rich centers. So these are some of the ways you can develop the youth, you can promote the youth and focus on the minority sections of the youth. Now, when it comes to youth and you have trained the youth, you have educated the youth, what's the next biggest question? The next biggest question is job opportunities. So job creation is again a way forward, where you have 60% of the population in the age group of 15 to 60 years approximately, where nearly 10 million young people are added every year. You need to create at least 10 million jobs every year to accommodate those young people who are coming into the market. So the number of jobs that are created is not at par to the labor market. Again, the number of jobs that are created are mostly in the unskilled sector. So you have to develop more skilled jobs, more skill opportunities for the same. Some of the schemes that have come up include the Prime Minister Employment Generation Program, Swarn Jayanti Gram Swarojgar Program, and then you have Swarn Jayanti Shahri Rojgar Program. So one is for the rural area, the other is for the urban area. Then you have projects like Make in India, Skill India. All these aim to promote more employment opportunities in India itself. Now, if we talk about unemployment figures, it approximately comes to 13% in the age group of 18 to 28 years, which is considered as 8 times higher for the unemployment ratio if we work around for a higher age group from 30 plus. So that means 30 plus unemployment is around 1.6%, but the employment unemployment in the age group of 18 to 28 years is around 13%. So that's a very huge figure, and we say it's around 8 times the unemployment in the higher age group. So different ministries are creating jobs under different policies and programs. You had the startup and the stand-up initiative, as we said. It promotes small entrepreneurships and helps the people in tax benefits. You have Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. It provides microcredit facilities for the small businesses. The Startup Village Entrepreneurship Program, SVEP, that promotes entrepreneurship in rural areas. Now, you have the census that talks about the youth, we saw. And then you have the worker participation ratio, as you can see. Now, 15 to 17 years is considered as separate because most of the time this age group students are youth is not counted in the actual participation rate. So you have the actual participation rate that falls in 18 to 29 years, and if you look on to the total, there are around 39% who are engaged. However, if 30 plus is considered, you have around 58% of the population that is engaged. When we talk about the unemployment scenario, as we saw, unemployment is 13% here, but in case of 30 plus, it's only 1.6%. So unemployment for the educated youth is a much higher challenge. So there needs to be ways in which we need to fight this. Again, urban female is highly unemployed. So that's again a biggest question that is being asked. If we look on to the industrial distribution, you have the age group of 18 to 29 and 30 plus, you can see self-employed, the youth is less than the middle age group population. Salaried employed, the youth is much higher. Contract workers, the youth is much higher. And casual workers, again, the youth is much higher. So what needs to be focused on is self-employment, creating more startup companies, more startup projects, where you have more small scale industries and more individual establishments that are coming up, which can further provide employment to more and more people. Now, making a nation of job creators is one of the biggest challenges that India is facing. When we talk of the process of industrialization, we say we would be accommodating more and more people in the job sector. However, then comes the automation, which slowly and gradually takes away the job. So the recent, you have the IT tsunami, which is in news, that talks about the automation in the IT industry. industries. As a result, you have the job loss that has been come up, that is being coming up in the private companies or the software development companies like TCS, Infosys and so on. So entrepreneurship, as we know, creates the demand for the various units. So the idea is to focus on entrepreneurship, increase more startups which can provide employment to more and more people. Around 90% of the funding comes from foreign venture capitals or domestic financiers, and 94% of the new businesses fail during the first year of the operation itself. So only 6% of the businesses turn out to be successful. So that's the figure where we need to improve a lot. And lack of fund is one of the major reasons why most of the institutions do not run well. Now, how this funding can be challenged? There are various ways in which a startup can be funded. Now, let's look about some of these terms. These terms are not only important as a part of Yojana, but important for your economics section. So, your economics is covered here. The first is Pradhan Mantri Micro Unit and Refinancing Agency Limited, that issues the Mudra card. Mudra card is similar to a credit card and it's used to give loan. The corpus of 20,000 crores can be extended to 10 lakh medium and small enterprise. Now, bootstrapping or self-funding is another way where you yourself fund your startup. Then you have crowdfunding, when you take loans or pre-orders, not from one person, but more than one person at a given point of time. Angel investments say that some people have surplus cash or surplus to invest, and they would invest and they try to risk up. So they have the preference to take the risk and they invest the money. The next is venture capitalists. Venture capitalists are professionally managed funds and they invest in the company where they feel they have a potential to grow. So if I feel that there is a company which has a potential to grow, I would go and invest in that company, and that is known as venture capitalist. The next is business incubators and business accelerators. Business incubators are those which help or assist in the development of the business. Business accelerators are those which help to run the business at a regular pace. Then you have the microfinance providers who provide the access to the financial services. So Startup India program laid down the 19-point action program. This is again very important. Startup India is an important question that could be asked. Now, what are the 19 points that have been laid down? Protecting the patent, online registration, providing a startup hub, self-certification compliance, no capital gains, no income tax for the first 3 years, building entrepreneurships, faster exit, easy rules for startups. So all this would help in the ease of doing business that we study. So when you have the ease of doing business, if you don't have to file the income tax for 3 years, if you don't have to show capital gains, then the startups would have more easier way to grow and develop. So these are some of the ways in which government has provided startups more opportunity to grow. Tax exemption is also there for investment of higher value than the market price. So these are some of the important points that you must know. Now, youth is definitely an active agent of change. Youth has the power, capacity and the energy to drive. Youth works around with the labor market. So labor market is totally governed by the condition of the youth. So if the youth is healthy and fit, you have a good labor market. Now this labor market needs to be properly engaged in. So unemployment rate should be reduced, more worker population ratio should be enhanced, and the participation rate should be increased. Then for employing the youth, you have to make up various programs like skill development and entrepreneurship policy was launched in 2015. Then you need to leverage the youth power. That's again very important. Now, what are the key elements? The key elements is mapping the aspiration of the youth, that talks about covering the employment opportunities, then mobilizing the scaling. That means India needs to skill 110 million people and reskill around 300 million people by 2022. Once they are reskilled, they can be better employed, they can have better productivity. So skill Sakhi model in Maharashtra is one such example. Addressing the diversity where you talk about the sectoral gender and spatial diversity with 93% employment in informal sector, that should be moved on to the formal sector. Providing the people with a second chance, that is relearning, prior learning or reskilling the people. School to work transition surveys should be conducted. So these are some of the initiatives that should be worked around. Now one is the Sagarmala and the Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gramin Kaushal Yojana Convergence that talks about development of the rural areas close to the coastal areas, where you have the Sagarmala project that's going on. Now funding for the scheduled caste, you have this was launched in 2014-15 with a around 230 crore loan that was sanctioned to 65 SC entrepreneurs. Around 17 lakh people were benefited from the subsidy loans and 8.12 lakh loans were given by corporations of entrepreneurship. Now, who are the flag bearers of Indian culture? The Indians who are spread throughout the world, or the Indian diaspora across the world, is considered as the flag bearer of Indian culture. So the idea is to understand the proper youth power, I would say. So as you can say, the median age for the international migrants is 39 years. Now 25 million of the Indian diaspora exists worldwide, of which US has 3.2 million Indians. Then you have 60,000 youth trained doctors from India, which are sent worldwide in 2010. By 2025, India would be the youngest country in the world with a median age of 26 years. You have the skilled people who are going to Silicon Valley in US, California. Then you have the Oxbridge and the London, where you have 2 million British Indian citizens. So globalization is basically a pull factor that is attracting more immigration. Swami Vivekananda explained the ideas of religious tolerance in his Chicago summit, and he explained how the Indian youth can basically benefits. Now, what are some of the brain gains? The brain gains is what are the facilities you are providing to the Indian diaspora spread across the world. So the first effort was merger of the PIO and the OCI, the people of Indian origin and the overseas citizens of India card. Then is conducting Pravasi Bharati Divas, the Youth Pravasi Bharati Divas, the Pravasi Bharati Kendra, Vajra Visiting Adjunct, JRF, the Joint Research Faculty, and the most important is Know India program that aims to familiarize the Indian diaspora staying abroad with the Indian culture. Now, bringing the healthy lifestyle, that's the key aspect. So you have 21st June, which is now celebrated as the International Yoga Day. Health is a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being, and not only the absence of disease. So that's the key element. So when we say bringing in complete physical, mental and social well-being, it's a kind of spiritual discipline that yoga brings in with Kriya, that is the purificatory process, Surya Namaskar, that is salutation to the sun, various asanas or the physical postures, pranayama or the breathing practices, and finally dhyana or meditation and relaxation. So it aims to promote a healthy life, manage the lifestyle and prevent illness. Now this only not only focuses on the youth empowerment, it talks about the individual empowerment, it talks about the community empowerment and organizational empowerment. So yoga and youth, now the youth can have various diseases, so it could be to treat the various non-communicable diseases or communicable diseases, a change in the lifestyle and a kind of change in the way one sees the life. So some of the common problems that are being addressed by the youth is overweight, stress, anxiety, suicide tendencies, tobacco use, interpersonal violence or non-communicable diseases. Now all these problems can be answered by bringing in a much healthier lifestyle through the practice of yoga, the asanas and the pranayams. So that's again focus, again important focus that government is trying to bring around. Like you have the various schemes, you have yoga that has been introduced recently for the non-communicable diseases, for working around the obesity problems, for working around or removing the addiction problems. Now, pneumococcal conjugate vaccine has been introduced in the universal vaccination immunization program in India, and this pneumococcal disease is a cause of 20% of the global deaths. So that's again very important step taken by the government. Now, this section that we would be covering is not only important for your UPSC but also important for your NET examination. So this sections cover the portion on higher education. So distance and online entrepreneurship is a new concept that has come up. Now, most of the students who are not able to avail the regular courses because they are engaged in a kind of part-time or full-time job, they work around with a distance education program. Distance education program is a program where you can sit at your home or your place and work around the papers, go and give the exam. So that's a kind of mechanism that works around. So open and distance learning system has now emerged as a convenient and a flexible alternative to normal education system. It helps to provide more employment opportunities. Now, enrollment in the open education program, if we see on an all India basis, you can see it has a very high figures that has come up recently. Now, the idea is to promote the universalization of education through technology. We already talked about some of the statistics on entrepreneurship. Now, entrepreneurship programs have been released by different universities which are important. The most important is the EDII, that's Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India in Ahmedabad. Then you have Symbiosis University Pune, IGNU programs, Willinger University Mumbai, and West Bengal National University for Judicial Sciences in Kolkata. All these try to provide education to the youth, raise the need for the trained personals, provide improvement in the qualification. You can get education even after retirement if you want to pursue education. There are micro entrepreneurships, there is formalization of informal sectors, and it's a kind of blended approach that has been started between the Entrepreneurship Development Institute at Ahmedabad and the Friedrich Naumann in Germany that talks about a kind of online program based on a blended approach. The idea is to provide more employment orientation, creating a virtual and real world, a kind of real education sector that could be seen in with more authenticity and credibility. Now, Northeast is again a very, very important sector that needs to be focused on. As we said, we have discussed in the classes on map location, Northeast is being given higher priority these days. So you have the Krishi Karman Award for 2015 and 16 that was given to Tripura. Fifth Northeast Center for the kind of National Institute for Electronics and IT has been opened at Agartala, which is again a capital of Tripura. You have the Airports Authority of India, which provides ambulance services for Arunachal Pradesh areas. Then some of the other developments includes the Isha Uday, which is a scholarship scheme for Northeast. Ishan Vikas, which is providing fellowships to the talented students. The first national sports university set up at Manipur. You have the six new agriculture colleges which are being established in Northeast. Tripura is being connected with a broad gauge on the railway map, and Sikkim is the first state to become a fully organic state. So these are some of the initiatives for the Northeast. Now, quality education to empower youth is very, very important. This can be achieved only by education for all, and the key idea is to educate and employ the youth of India. So the four pillars of youth empowerment includes education, skill development, radical temperamental change, and government policies. So these are the four key areas. Now, if we see what are the hurdles in the education, there are certain crunches like lack of facilities, lack of autonomy. Then some of the materials have got obsolete, out of data curriculum, which are kind of shelled approach. Then you have non-involvement of the employer industry. Now, what we need to focus on is a quadrant empowerment of Indian youth that talks about the student-centric approach, the employer-centric approach, the NBCS. Then you have the cooperatives work and the government initiatives. Together, these four form the quadrant approach model. Now, expansion of education for the youth is very, very important. All these programs we have covered in our separate class where we have talked about higher education in India. So the Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan, the global initiatives, then you have the imprint scheme, the Uchchatar Avishkar scheme, the ranking scheme, all these have been discussed in the class on higher education. So for details on all these, you can go on to the class on higher education. We'll have the link below the video also. Then you have the new portals that are being established by Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan that talks about the mobile app being released by the MHRD. The idea is to bring the youth to the mainstream, specifically from the sectors where there is less exposure. So let's say from the regions of Mesoist insurgency, regions of Northeast. So there is a Mesoist insurgency affected red corridor. This red corridor is the region of eastern, central and southern parts of India that experienced the Naxalist or the Mesoist insurgency. Then you have the various programs that have been launched under the skill development. So Ministry of Skill Development and related program. The policy of Tare Zami Par, which is an initiative of Jharkhand government to work around the children in the affected areas of Palmau district. Then Prayas is one of the efforts in Chhattisgarh to prepare the students for various competitive exams. Then this was around about the Northeast, the Mesoist insurgency areas. Then you have for the Northeast, you have 100 crores that has been given to the startups. The growth of various IT sectors, food processing units and healthcare in the Northeast India. The Department of Northeast Region Ministry, which offers subsidy incentives for the Northeast regions, mainly for hospitality, tourism building, nursing, paramedical, wellness and beauty and retail. So these are the basic areas that are being focused for the Northeast. Then you have the terrorist affected regions of Jammu Kashmir. Udaan is a scheme that has got a very good response in Jammu and Kashmir. Then this has been funded by the Ministry of Home Affairs. Then you have Sadbhavna, which runs many army programs. The army runs the various programs for the youth of Jammu Kashmir. That's the Army Goodwill Schools, the National Integration Tours, the Vocational Training Program and the Kashmir Super 40 Initiative, that is coaching the youth in Jammu and Kashmir for engineering entrance exam. Similarly, you have Himmat, which is a Ministry of Rural Development Initiative under the Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gramin Kaushal Yojana. It trains the 1.24 lakh youth of Jammu and Kashmir for jobs in the vocational sector. Now comes the most important thing, GST, which is a very, very important thing for your upcoming mains examination and also for your next prelims. GST, the goods and service tax, which has been called as a good and simple tax, talks about the merger of nearly more than 500 taxes which have been levied by the center and the state in different forms, like the lottery tax, the state tax, the road tax, the sales tax, VAT, excise, customs and so on. So there would be three taxes, that is CGST, SGST and IGST. SGST is the state GST, central GST and the integrated GST. This integrated GST is looked by the center itself and it would be levied on the supply of goods and services. Its aim is one nation, one market. It has been proposed to levy a kind of dual taxation systems under the center and the state so that the funds are allocated equally. Now the central government would levy taxes on manufacturers like central excise, you have service tax and interstate sale of goods. Then what are the advantages of GST? One unified market, common procedures, reducing the tax burden on an individual, reducing the human interference, reducing the role of intermediaries or ghost intermediaries, boost export and manufacturing, reducing poverty. And what is the advantage to the trade and industry? The advantage is the tax regime would be much simpler. There would be increased focus with reduced compliance cost, no double taxation, reduction in the multiplicity of the taxes which are being levied, a simple process and reducing the average tax burden. The advantage to the customer is reduction in the poverty. More small retailers would benefit. Prices would go down and the final prices would be much more transparent to the customer. To the states, they would have more expansion of the tax base, bring destination based taxation system, have overall investment that would be improved, more incentives would be given for to remove invasion, and compliance would become much more easier. So the council meeting talks to focus on that was held aims to focus on the following objectives, that is on the limit of exemption, the time for implementation, the rules to conduct the business, compensate the state for the 5 years of lost revenue, and so on. So these are very, very important. What were the highlights for the council meeting? Then what are the challenges to implement? The challenges is working with the time frame which is being rolled out on the 1st of July. So within the 2 months, the first 2-3 months would definitely be difficult for most of the businessmen. Then you have the process of draft laws that have been given by the state legislatures. The infrastructure needs to be upgraded, the softwares need to be upgraded, the individuals need to be familiarized with the process and the softwares and how to work around and file GST every time. So IT sectors need to be upgraded. Then you have the Rashtrapati Bhavan series of books that has been brought by Publication Division of India. Now this has come up with the Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts that we have covered in the class on the cultural institutes, and has been designed by Sahapvidya, which is an agency of Indira Gandhi Center for National Arts. So this is the list of 17 books. You would have the handout, so you can go through those. So with this we cover the summary, or I would say the highlights of the Yojana June 2017. We would be covering more issues on Yojana in Kurukshetra in the upcoming lectures. Stay tuned. Have a good day ahead.